Groups of gazing pilgrims stood around all and every of these strange objects, lost in reverent wonder, and envious of the fleckless sanctity which these pious austerities had won for them from an exacting heaven. By and by we went to see one of the supremely great ones. He was a mighty celebrity. His fame had penetrated all Christendom. The noble and the renowned journeyed from the remotest lands on the globe to pay him reverence. His stand was in the center of the widest part of the valley, and it took all that space to hold his crowds. His stand was a pillar 60 feet high, with a broad platform on top of it. He was now doing what he had been doing every day for 20 years up there, bowing his body ceaselessly and rapidly almost to his feet. It was his way of praying. I timed him with a stopwatch, and he made 1,244 revolutions in 24 minutes and 46 seconds. It seemed a pity to have all this power going to waste. It was one of the most useful motions in mechanics, the pedal movement. So I made a note in my memorandum-book, proposing some day to apply a system of elastic cords to him and run a sewing machine with it. I afterward carried out that scheme and got 5 years' good service out of him, in which time he turned out upward of 18,000 first-rate tow-linen shirts, which was 10 a day. I worked him Sundays and all. He was going Sundays, the same as weekdays, and it was no use to waste the power. These shirts cost me nothing but just the mere trifle for the materials. I furnished those myself. It would not have been right to make him do that. And they sold like smoke to pilgrims at $1.50 apiece, which was the price of 50 cows, or a blooded racehorse in Arthurdom. They were regarded as a perfect protection against sin, and advertised as such by my knights everywhere, with the paint-pot and stencil-plate, insomuch that there was not a cliff or boulder or a dead wall in England, but you could read on it, at a mile distance, "By the only genuine St. Stylite, patronized by the nobility, patent applied for." There was more money in the business than one knew what to do with. As it extended, I brought out a line of goods suitable for kings, and a knobby thing for duchesses and that sort, with ruffles down the forehatch, and the running gear clewed up with a feather stitch to the leeward, and then hauled aft with a backstay, and triced up with a half-turn in the standing rigging forward of the weather-gaskets. Yes, it was a daisy. But about that time I noticed that the motive power had taken to standing on one leg, and I found that there was something the matter with the other one. So I stocked the business and unloaded, taking Sir Bors de Ganis into camp financially along with certain of his friends, for the work stopped within a year, and the good saint got him to his rest. But he had earned it. I can say that for him.